Good morning. Good morning, lovely humans. I do want to say, I'm going to remember to make this announcement. There are many lilies up here. If you bought one, be sure and get it after the service. And if you did not buy one, come get one and pick it up. They're so beautiful. They shouldn't go to waste sitting here during the week. So take it to somebody who could use some beautiful flowers in their life. Good morning. Welcome. Welcome to all of you sharing this space, as well as those who are sharing our virtual space. Happy Sunday. And congratulations for showing up on Low Sunday. That's what people in the biz call the Sunday after Easter. You know, that's a good measurement of a church, is not how many people are there on Easter Sunday, but how many people are there the week after. Thank you for showing up. This day is memorable for me because I vividly remember 2 years ago, on the Sunday after Easter, standing right here for the very first time. It was the candidate weekend. Many of you will remember when we made it official. You called me as your lead minister. Bill Kemp, you were there. Yes. 2 years later, we're still on our honeymoon. Maybe it's just going to be a good marriage. How about that? It's the first Sunday of the month, which means it's multi-generational Sunday. The kids remain in worship today, and we'll all share communion together. So if you're at home, grab some bread and juice or wine. I mean, it's only 10 o'clock in the morning, but I'm not going to judge. There's also a bit of a change in our worship order today. The kids' time will be after the sermon, right before communion. Sarah and I have something special planned for the kids. It's all in your bulletin. I just wanted to give you the heads up. We also welcome Sandi today. It's good to have you. You're often here, but now you're here solo, and we're lucky that you're here. Some of the staff, David, Josh, and Rachel, are taking some... Yes. Oh, sorry. I didn't mean to step on your applause. You're deserving. Sarah and Josh and Rachel are taking some well-deserved, David and Josh and Rachel are taking some well-deserved vacation time today. Hey, there's my son and my grandson. Hey, kid. Okay. Sorry, I'm easily distracted today, I guess. Friends, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. In joy and gratitude, let us worship together.
Please rise in body or spirit and join me in the call of worship. We thought the story was finished. We thought the hope had ended. We thought that when the tomb was sealed, that was it. But this is it. Friends, may the peace of the risen Christ be with you. Let us greet one another with peace.
Is when you'll get up.
Please be seated. Please join me in the prayers of the people. Holy and loving God, you are there in our anxious nights and our restless minds. We are gathered together to feel, hear, and absorb your presence. A lingering feeling of joy is here as we remember the Easter celebration last Sunday, the white linens, the flowering cross, the Alleluia banner. And yet our world holds new challenges this week. War and instability, natural disasters, more conflicts arise every day. We use this prayer to give our concerns to your capable hands, concerns of illness, grief, uneasiness, concerns of the well-being of others, ourselves, the world, concerns of our climate, our government, our home. Quiet seems elusive as the routine sounds of life become background noise. Soothe our ruminating in the depth of our breath that reminds our body that we are here, now, safe, and release the tension in our chests. There's a quiet place within. It is our inner sanctuary where we get to listen. Holy God, thank you for this moment of peace. May it remain with us the rest of the day. Remind us that if we stop and get a blessing from the still place deep in our soul, then the knots of our life are loosened. We pray this today as you also taught your disciples to pray. Our Creator in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We're so grateful for this community. What makes it possible is all of you. The gifts that we share, our resources, our time, our talent. Now is the time when we contribute to the life of our church that we may successfully engage in the ministry that God has given to us to do. Please remain seated as we sing and we will receive the morning offering. Ushers.
Our scripture today is from the Gospel of John. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, He showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained."
Thank you, Natalie. Isn't she a great reader? Fabulous. Excellent. A week or so ago, I was running around the church, whistling loudly. I often do that. Let's wait. I'm waiting for the teleprompter. At some point, I will learn how to vamp good enough that I don't have to say I'm waiting for the teleprompter, but I'm not good enough yet. I'm not good enough yet. And I will say the volunteer that I am going to be referencing is here today. Judy Cunningham, raise your hand. Yes, okay. Still not done. Can we move forward faster? Who says silence has to be awkward? I do. There we go. Okay. A week or so ago, I was running around the church. I was whistling loudly. I often whistle. It's a habit that I've had since I was a child. And as I wrote this sermon, I remembered this really distinct memory about whistling. I was very, very young. Our family was in the den. We were watching TV at night, so it was dark in the house. And my mom asked me to go to another room and get something for her. But when I started to do it, I looked in the hallway, it was dark, and I was afraid. This is one of the ways that my mother taught me resiliency. She said, "Leanne, here's what you do. Just whistle as you go down the hallway." And then she sang that song from The King and I, "Whenever I feel afraid, I hold my head erect and whistle a happy tune so no one will suspect I'm afraid." That's right, my mother taught me denial from an early age. And now that I note the lyrics, it's kind of odd that it doesn't say, "I whistle so I don't have to be afraid." It's so no one will know I'm afraid. Denial and shame. Gifts that keep on going. Thanks, Mom. So, last week when I was whistling, Judy, sitting at the office desk, laughed and she said, "My mother used to say, whistling girls and crowing hens will always come to some bad ends." And I told the volunteer, "My mother said that too." I guess both of our mothers expected us to come to bad ends, but we proved them wrong, didn't we? More shame. Why am I prattling on about whistling? This, my friends, is the beginning of the sermon when I try to draw you in with a personal anecdote that relates to the sermon. In this case, it's an intro to the rest of the text for today. Natalie got us started with the first part of the story about the disciples on that first Easter evening gathering when, according to John's imagination, a stranger mysteriously passes through locked doors to reveal himself as Jesus. Yes, Jesus post-crucifixion. As the story continues, we get to the familiar part about a notorious disciple who doubted. His name was Thomas, Doubting Thomas. Now, the biblical passage is printed in your bulletin, but instead of reading it, I'm just going to tell you the story as I remember it as a child. Jesus was risen from the dead. Everybody knew it. Everybody was on board except this bad, stupid disciple named Thomas. And Thomas said, "I will not believe until I touch Jesus' bloody hands and side." And finally, Jesus said, "Oh, Thomas, here." And he showed him his wounds. And then Jesus scolded Thomas, and he said, "Everybody else believed me, but you doubted." Now remember, I'm telling you this story through the lens of my childhood understandings. because that is not the way the story reads. Jesus doesn't scold Thomas. He freely offers himself. Jesus gives Thomas what he needs to believe. And Thomas responds, "My Lord and my God." But for me as a child who had a lot of questions, for whatever reason, my takeaway from this story was shame. Now, was that due to the bias of my Sunday school teacher? Maybe. Was it something in my personality or my family system? Who knows? What I do know is that I absorbed a sense of shame from church. Shame was an undeniable takeaway from church for me. And I've spent decades trying to understand better how I picked that up. Because as a minister serving a church, it's very, very important to me that church not perpetuate shame. Shame is that feeling of humiliation or distress or inadequacy. My fellow Texan, Brené Brown, I like dropping her name like I know her, says that shame drives two big tapes that play in your head. Never good enough, and if you can talk yourself out of that one, she says, the second one is, who do you think you are? She says the thing to understand about shame is that shame is not guilt. Shame is a focus on self. Guilt is a focus on behavior. Guilt is, I did something bad. Shame is, I am bad. If you do something hurtful to another person, you might say, I'm sorry, I made a mistake. Shame says, I'm sorry, I am a mistake. Brown says that shame is highly correlated with addiction, depression, violence, aggression, bullying, suicide, eating disorders. It's the opposite with guilt, because the ability to hold something that we have done or failed to do up against what we wanted to do, it's uncomfortable, it can be painful, but we tend to adapt well to that, she writes. Shame is another story. Shame can lead us to feel depressed and anxious. It can prompt us to be overly responsible and to excessively seek approval. Another thing, shame is deeply embedded in the Christian tradition. How many know the old hymn, How Great Thou Art? I love that hymn. I've been singing it for as long as I can remember. But take that third verse. And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. That hymn represents the simple faith of my childhood, which went something like this. Human sin brought death into the world. We, all of us, are born into sin. That's what it means to be human, that we embody sin. And human sin deserves punishment. That's just the way it is. But God, in all his compassion, sent Jesus to break our bondage to sin. And so Jesus's death, as I was taught, was all a part of God's plan, because only a divine sacrifice can free us from sin and ensure eternal life rather than the eternal damnation that I deserved. How Great Thou Art does not appear in our hymnal. The New Century hymnal that we typically use rewrites much of the hierarchical, shame-inducing lyrics of a lot of those old hymns, and I'm glad it does. But shame is still found throughout our hymns. Last week was Easter. The music was magnificent. Easter hymns are just transcendent, aren't they? We opened with a hymn that I have loved ever since my days as an Episcopalian a few decades ago, Lift High the Cross. And when I was singing it, I just felt so happy, hearing the choir and the brass and seeing these beautiful swooping white cloths. But then I just sort of cringed when it goes on to say things like, Oh Christ, once lifted on the glorious tree, your death has brought us life eternally. When I sing that, I just think, wait a minute, martyrdom, violence is not what makes me right with God. Christ the Lord is risen today, the joyful Easter hymn. But do I really believe that love's redeeming work is done? It seems like there's a lot more work to do. The last hymn was, Jesus Christ is risen today. Who did once upon the cross suffer to redeem our loss? Again and again, this message. You're human. You deserve death. So Jesus had to die to save you. It all comes down to this idea. God loves you in spite of yourself. How much damage has been done by that sentiment? Countless people believe that these are the only possible Christian understandings of the cross, understandings of forgiveness of sin and salvation. And a lot of those people have left the church because these beliefs, as I've just expressed them, they no longer reflect their personal experiences. Or it offends their ethical and spiritual sensibilities. They're looking for good news beyond God's sacrifice of his innocent son for the sake of salvation. These orthodoxies of the past that instill shame may have provided assurance for us once upon a time, but to many of us who call ourselves Christian, they no longer make sense. We do not believe in a God who requires death to make things right. What would a shame-free church look like? I've been thinking about this week. I'm not sure, but I think it would be something like this. We would prioritize compassion, acceptance, and understanding above all else. How we treat one another would be more important than what any one individual believes. As an antidote to guilt or shame, we'd foster an atmosphere of non-judgment where people feel safe to be themselves without fear of condemnation. Instead of doctrines or dogmas, we'd have an open dialogue and discussion, a curious discussion, where all perspectives would be respected. A focus on growth, empowerment, and fulfillment of potential would replace emphasis on sin and punishment. In a shame-free church, there would still be accountability in place to address the possibility of harmful behavior. The emphasis would be on restoration and reconciliation rather than punishment. In a shame-free church, people could be authentic and vulnerable, trusting that they would be met with understanding and support rather than judgment or shame. Overall, a shame-free church would be characterized by its commitment to acceptance and the affirmation of the inherent worth and dignity of every individual, and it would characterize God as a presence of unconditional love for humans, humans created of original blessing, not original sin. It would be a place where people feel truly seen, heard, and valued, and where they are empowered to live authentically and make positive contributions to the world. That's the kind of church I want to be a part of. And in many ways, we already are that kind of church. At least we strive to be, and in some ways we succeed. In some ways, and from time to time, we surely fall short. It's a powerful thing when people come together with a shared vision. May we continue to strive to be a shame-free church in which people can draw near to the risen Christ by drawing near to what his body looks like now, the body of Christ. Amen.
I'd like to invite the children up to the chancel where we will have the children's message.
Come on
down. We're actually going to stand up here. This is a little different from normal. Yeah, come on up. We're going to gather
around this table.
Yeah, join us. Awesome.
So, when y'all have family gatherings, do you have like big dinners where you have a lot more people over sometimes? Come on down. Come on up. Come on.
Yeah, there's room.
You know, we do, and that's awesome. That's fun on holidays where there's room for everybody. Sometimes it's hard to cram everybody around there. Sometimes they have different tables and different rooms to fit everybody in. But everybody gets together, and it's a way of showing love and connecting with each other to eat together. That's what this table is. This is our communion table. We wanted you to see it up close because you might not know, like under here, there's the bread. So there's four. I'll just be the one to touch it if that's okay, because we don't. There's four. Because we have four stations. Yeah, Sarah, you show that. This is juice. At our church, we use gluten-free bread always. And we use grape juice just because we want everybody to be able to participate, no matter what their situation. So we try to do that. And Always when I stand up here, or whoever is officiating at communion, you'll hear me do a kind of a welcome. That's the first thing. You want people to know, hey, in this church, everybody can come. We want everybody to be a part of this meal. And then I'll tell the story about when Jesus gathered with, he was at a time of betrayal by some of his friends, and some of his friends left him alone when he was about to face a really difficult thing. And so to strengthen himself, he gathered with his friends, and they shared a meal. And after that meal, he took bread that was left over, like this leftover bagel here. I mean, he was Jewish, right? So he took the bread left over from dinner, and he said, he broke it. He said, thank you, God, for this bread. And he said, I'm not going to always be here with you. And so when I'm gone, this is what I want you to do. I want you to take bread like this, and I want you to share it with everybody. Never be stingy. Share it with everybody. And I want you to remember me. And another way, I want you to drink this wine for us, juice. I want you to drink this as a reminder that it's all about love. That's what really matters, is love. And so share this bread and this cup when I'm no longer here, and that way you'll know that I'm with you. So what we're going to do, well, why don't you talk about the communion servers, and then I'll say what we're going to do.
Okay. So you guys may have noticed our last multi-gen service, it's always the first Sunday of the month, we had some kids helping to serve communion. I don't know if some of you saw that, but we're going to try to have kids and youth participate in serving communion a little more often, sort of, and also reading scripture, sort of like Natalie did today. So today we have two children who will help to serve communion, and if that's something you might be interested in for a future Sunday, like let me know or talk to Reverend Leanne, yeah, because we value when you serve like that. It means a lot for people in the congregation to receive from you.
That's right. Thank you. Today it's Sawyer and Amelia who are going to help serve in just a minute, but it could be you next time, because it's a gift that you can bring the congregation by doing this really very important job. The last thing that I do at the table usually is offer a prayer before we share communion. So let's pray now. Dear God, may this bread and this cup be for us what they have been to so many. May they help us feel your love. May they help us feel connected to this beautiful church. And may they give us what we need right now, strength or perseverance. May we just know that you are with us through this meal. Amen. Now what we're going to do is serve y'all communion first. And Sarah and I will serve, let's see, I'll do the bread and you do the cup, how's that? And as we do that, let's kind of come over to this direction to serve so that the servers for the full communion can make your way to the chancel. This is bread of life. Gus, this is the bread of new life. Why don't we skip trade places? This is new. Always remember, Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. Amelia, this is the bread of new life. Sawyer, this is the bread of new life. Maggie, the bread of new life. Hi, Jesus loves you. Hi, what's your name? Nice to meet you, Caleb. And the juice is right over there if you want to dip it in. Okay, take a piece of bread and remember that God loves you. Perfect. And you can dip it in there. Would you like some? Okay. The bread of new life. What's your name? This is the bread of new life, Jason. Hello, hi, sweetheart. The bread of life. Just take whatever it is.
Thank you.
Oh God, we give you thanks for your love for us, for your provision, for your presence with us through the journeys of our lives, and for this blessed community from which we gain support and care and encouragement. Be with us now as we go forth from this place with an easy job, simply to show love. Amen. Please stand for our closing hymn. Friends, this too can be yours. Don't forget, let's get these beautiful flowers, these reminders of this Easter season of new life. Let's get them spread around so people can enjoy them. After worship today, great opportunities for children. There's no youth today, but children are meeting, and we have Becoming in the library and interactive adult education. And then also we have in the chapel, we have the forum, and our own Minette Church will be speaking. Come to something. And Lisa November is our Stephen minister for the day. So you'll be down here, babe? Yes. If you want to pray with somebody, you can't beat that one right there, I tell you what. And now take this joy and love and connection that you feel and spread it around. Spread it around. Be generous with our love and know that peace can be ours, that God is with us, that we are with each other. In the name of our God, who is our creator and our redeemer and our sustainer, go blessed, friends. Amen.